So the two occluded vehicles that are interesting, one is the vehicle that's in front of you blocked by an idiot in a big SUV who's stopping your view of what's going forward. And the other one is a blind corner and someone running through a stop sign or running through a traffic light at a blind corner. And so yes, it could provide that. But let's take a look at that. When you get this into 25 million cars, that means about 10% of all cars will have the technology. The two to talk together, 1% of such incidents would be detected by that. Very few technologies are successful if they provide no value to the first 25 million adopters. The only way you could ever get a technology to work like that is if you legally require it, because you'll never get past your 25 million adopters when you do that. Now, if you have the radio, it is admittedly 10% better for you, but for the government as a policy standpoint, it's 1/100th. When they get to 50% in 2030, it's finally a quarter of these occluded vehicle incidents which might be detected because of that. But there are other ways to detect these occluded vehicles. Now, one thing with the car in front of you, it turns out radar has a magic ability. Radar actually does see the car behind that SUV because it bounces off of the road and other things around you. Not all the time, but a lot of time it does see that. Tesla actually made a big deal recently about how their radar was detecting a car in an accident that you couldn't see, and then the camera reveals there's an accident, the Tesla was already alerted. That was the radar doing that magic thing. But if you want to look about the intersections, I think the best thing to do there is to put the money into having the traffic light have a camera, because we've now had this wonderful revolution in vision processing, which is making our vision system so much better. And if the traffic light sees someone running the light, to switch all the lights to red. Now that tells everyone, not just the people with radios, and not just the people with self-driving cars, stop. And so it actually benefits everybody, not just that 1% of radio. So I think there are better solutions to that particular problem. But as most of the people developing self-driving cars will say, we're not really making any plans to use DSRC and B2B communications. If they appear, sure, we'll probably use it. And I actually say probably, because there's a reason they might not. We'll probably use it. But they're not going to depend on it, and they're not going to slow things down at all in how they deploy things. Now, I could take some questions, but let me go and talk about this, because I got ahead about this chicken and egg problem that we face here. Because no communications technology has ever worked without providing benefit to the first person to buy it. Even the fax machine, you bought two fax machines, you put one in the branch office, one in the home office, you could fax. Much later, you could fax other people. Same with email. You put an email system in your company, you could mail people in your company, and then these internet guys came along and they let you email other people. All communications technologies have required them to be valuable to the first users before they, so they could ever get the traction that's needed to go forward. But the other mistake that people make when I talk about the other ways that we will do this, and I'm going to get into that, is that they say we need this direct line of sight communication because that's the only thing we can make fully reliable. That's the only thing we can make understand. We can understand its reliability. We're not dependent on anything else. But the problem is that a 99% probability technology that's only deployed in 50% of vehicles is worse than a 90% reliable technology that's deployed in all the vehicles. There already is a technology that by 2020 will be in all the vehicles. All right. Now, this technology is not as reliable as putting in a dedicated radio into the car and giving it its own antenna and having it communicate with other things. But if you were to go to the companies who make these and say, listen, if you will just put in a little car-to-car protocol in this that will warn people about they're going to hit somebody. If you'll just put that in, we'll give you this 5.9 gigahertz spectrum so you can have more spectrum for your phone to do things. You just put that in. And I'll tell you, that because this is a year old, this thing I'm holding in my hand, and I'm going to buy the new model of it probably in about 4 months. And all of you have done the same. These go through a new technology generation every 2 years. Cars go through a new technology generation. Right now, every 20 years, the design on a car starts 7 years before the car comes out. It's finalized about 3 years before it comes out. The cell phone here is running software written yesterday. No car is doing that, except maybe the Tesla, and it wasn't even written yesterday. So you never beat this. That's the real lesson. This wins over anything if it can do it. How many cars have you got that have got $2,000 navigation systems in them that you bought as part of the expensive technology package? I know you're not going to put up your hands because you're ashamed. But you bought them. And 3 years later, did you still turn it on? No, because it was better in here. And it always will be because this is being replaced every 2 years. You cannot defeat that. And so it's the wrong approach to do. Now then we get problems about the information you might get from another car. The first thing is it might be inaccurate. You didn't build it. When you build a self-driving car, you're really focused on certifying it and making sure it meets the specs that you require. All right? But you didn't build the other car out there that's telling you what it sees or what it's doing. So you don't know how good that is. You can hope it's good. You might get a look at the manufacturer and say, I trust Nissan, but I don't trust Mazda or something like that. But you didn't build it. It's not under your control. It might be inaccurate. Now, worse than that, though, it might be lying to you. It might be teenagers saying, ha, 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 let's broadcast. There's a car stalled in the middle of the freeway at rush hour, and all the cars brake for it. I mean, I don't know if that'll happen a lot, but it's certainly something that becomes possible. But worst of all, and the reason that this is actually, the real reason I talk about that, is it might be attacking you. It might be trying to break into you. Now, the problem is this. All the plans for vehicle-to-vehicle communication, vehicle-to-infrastructure communication, provide data of use to the driving system. They're not for the infotainment system. I don't care if someone comes in there and changes my music to trance. Well, I do care, but that's not a big issue. If they can get into my driving system, I'm much more concerned about it. This is a 2,000 kilogram robot that can wander around going all pristine on people. Right. This is not something we want to have happen. So I think we want to teach our cars the same thing we teach our children. Do not talk to strangers. I'm not saying every car is out to get into you, but in the computer security world, we have a phrase. We say attack surfaces, which means ways that someone could get in. And you don't want to open more attack surfaces. I believe we need to secure the driving systems of these cars better than we've secured almost everything out there, because we're talking about millions of 2,000 kilogram robots with big engines that could do very serious things. If I were the People's Liberation Army, I would probably have planted employees on the teams of several major self-driving car projects already. Because that's not that expensive. And everyone's very hungry for talent. And if someone comes up to you with a fantastic resume, do you look that deeply into everything in their background? I don't know if you do. And we're talking about the ability to kill more people than a nuclear weapon at a much lower cost than a nuclear weapon. And maybe not even traced back to you, although I don't think you'd count on. It does sound like a bad movie. It sounds like a James Bond movie. Huh? Yeah, no, no, well, yeah, no, yes, yes. Suarez has written this story. Other people, no, I'm not the only person to think of this, absolutely. But what I'm saying is, unlike most of those movies, this is not out of the question. Right? And so you want to minimize the amount of communication. So I believe that these cars are going to talk only to their headquarters, and if they're smart, and their sensors. And if they're smart, they'll be paranoid about what they get from their own headquarters and from their own sensors. And the idea that we will have a government mandate saying every car should talk into every car it runs into and exchange messages in a complex protocol, that seems dicey to me, unless there was a big benefit. So yes, the occluded vehicles are a benefit. But do they justify a new attack surface? That's much harder to say. Yeah.
So given what you just said, are you proposing that on our phone we're just getting an alert and there's no interaction between the phone and the car?
That's correct.
The phone and the car need to actually talk to be able to. So you're proposing the car is the phone is sitting up on the dash, watching for itself and not getting information?
Your phone? Well, so I have an architecture that I have haven't released yet actually, and let me see if I'm going to skip ahead. Here we go. But oh no, I'll get to it in a second. Then it's too far ahead. But yes, that the driving system will not receive commands from the information entertainment portions, which is mostly your phone. Today in the car is this big console thing that they charge you $2,000 for. You'll notice Google's car had no dashboard because Google knows you don't want your music in your car. You want your music that you already have in the device you're carrying. They know that because they make that device. Apple makes that device. And other car companies have taken a while to figure that out. And then they produce these two things, Android Auto and Apple CarPlay, which really suck. And I'm sorry, but I think I blame the car companies rather than Apple and Google on that, but it could be not. I don't know the actual reason for the really bad design of those. But yes, now the car will stream information that the phone can get, so an outgoing stream, that's okay. So the phone could give you a nice interface where you can see everything that's going on. Your phone will be able to talk to the car's headquarters and say, I have a new destination for the car. And finally, there'll probably be a small screen and voice interface inside the car, especially if you're not connected to the network, where you can say, hey, stop now, or take me somewhere else, or do any of the basic interface commands you need to do with it. Yeah, that's That's the architecture I have. Communicate with as few as you possibly can and verify as much what you communicate with. Okay, this one's going to take some, we may not get through all this, but go ahead, at the back.
You're talking about strictly automobiles. The industry's bigger than that. I saw a demonstration of actually swarming technology used in construction equipment, and they laid out a 10,000-foot runway in about 6 hours. Cannot be done by man that way.
Sure. Yeah, for specialized tasks like that, a fleet of vehicles is going to build a runway, that's not a problem. That's a constrained environment, you know, that's not going to be something that foreign spies are going to take over. Now, so actually, when it comes to people taking over your car, I scare you a little bit with the foreign spies. I admit that is maybe that's in a Suarez novel or maybe it's something else. Mostly, you want to worry about how somebody could, organized crime could make money. So that's your car going and saying, hi, I've disabled the brakes. Please put in 2 Bitcoin if you would like them to work. That's probably the thing you should be most scared of. Someone trying, assassination is not, but most of us are hopefully not assassination targets. However, the use of this for assassination is not out of the question. For delivery of weapons, it's not out of the question. And for extortion against both people and car companies. That's another thing that I think would be the kind of threat models we actually have to deal with. But let's face it, the extreme threat model, the foreign government using it as a weapon, that's the least likely, but it's so big that you multiply the two together and it becomes something you want to worry about. There was another one over here, or yes, right there.
How can you expect that these cars to be more secure than what the computers have? If you would make computers more secure, you would not.
Oh, we do. I mean, even though today's cars are designed with absolutely no security in them at all, they're very rarely intruded into. So it's not impossible, and there are lots of people who've done sample demos of them. But there's lots, you have tons of computers in your life that have never been broken into. And partly it's the motive. Some don't have a motive to break in. Partly it's the amount of connectivity. Do you air gap the computer from the rest of the world, which is what we cannot fully air gap these, sorry, nerdy term. Air gap means no connection at all between two things by wires or even by air. You don't have Wi-Fi or optical with an air gap either. So it's badly named. But anyway, a lot of embedded systems that are highly secure, very small embedded systems, actually can be even formally proven to be correct, but that only applies to very small systems. So very complex systems, which is the kind of thing, I mean, Google's car runs on Linux. It's not one, where's Allison? Wonderful operating system, but not one that's that you're necessarily going to be able to prove secure or so on in when you deal with a problem like that. It's not impossible, though, to make a very, not very connected computer and give it that level of reliability. And in fact, the biggest question in self-driving cars today is actually how do we prove we have achieved the reliability? How do we test it? And this is what you'll see a lot more in, especially in conference law. You'll see whole conferences on how do we test this? How do we assure the reliability? How do we make sure that there are simply not even failures in the driving system, as well as to a lesser degree. One thing you do is you do what's called red team. You hire people in your own company or from outside companies to do everything they can to break into the computers, and you keep doing that constantly. And you see if they can find a way in, and if they do, you fix it as quickly as you can. You do heavy security audits. No code is checked into because someone in your company may be a spy, no code gets checked into the code base without being reviewed by security people as well as the technical people. This is the level of security that will be necessary to make these companies look. They are not going to be like Windows or Android or iOS. Blue screen of death, you don't want it to be really of death. that's not what's going to be running on these systems. Yeah.
Why can't people run through the security? I got this up back in the day. Why can't they have this interview?
Have a what?
Defense and intelligence service. Yeah,
they might, but they don't. They don't currently.
Sure.
Well, but most, you know, and that's not a perfect process, of course. There are people who get through that process. But nonetheless, yeah, I fear, actually, because I think it'd be a terrible way to run a team to have to do that or to have that level of suspicion. But I think it's something that should be on consideration. Now, I want to mention another alternative. We talked about this protocol, DSRC, which is a Wi-Fi style protocol. But since that was designed, there's been a lot of interesting work done at the mobile phone companies. Now, 5G isn't something that exists yet, but there's a whole bunch of new protocols planned to be part of that, which includes done with line of sight communications directly between two vehicles. And in fact, so companies like Qualcomm and the other guys who sell this, no surprise, are saying, instead of relying on this brand new radio protocol, why don't we use what everybody is already building, which has towers way up in the air. Example, the example John gave of the cars that can't see each other, two cars that can't see each other are also two cars that cannot communicate at 5.9 gigahertz reliably, because you need line of sight radio, but the cell towers that are up there can do that. The lower band waves, like the 700 megahertz waves, they can also go around corners and so on better. So these guys are saying, if we're going to have communication between cars, we should do it through our cell towers. I think they're mostly right from a technical standpoint. The other thing I don't like about it is simply the fact that it's their, you know, they own the cell towers, so we can't work without them, and I don't like that. In Barbuda, yesterday, every single cell tower was blown down. But on the other hand, I think it's very important that these cars have got to work without the communications at all. They have to be able to survive even that. Now, the situation that happened in the Caribbean and probably will happen at Mar-a-Lago in a couple days, now that's not fair to applaud, although I must admit I did it for a cheap laugh. But anyway, no, obviously, I actually felt bad. I saw someone in my Facebook feed, and of course, don't read your Facebook feed, but someone saying, oh, they were happy that the hurricane was going to hit Mar-a-Lago. I said, there's like thousands of people in West Palm Beach that are innocent, I hope. And we don't want that to happen. But one way or another, this battle's going to go on, and the cell companies do have a bit of technological answer, but more to the point, in the amount of time this protocol has stayed relatively static, they're at their fifth generation. In 2030, they'll be on whatever 7G is, they'll be on it. And it's going to do stuff that's beyond it. And this is part of the bet. And since I'm going to have to shorten, I may not get into all that stuff. Another thing that turns out that most people